Introductions are completed, therefore it is time for question period. Her Majesty's loyal opposition leader.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the acting premier. Despite the fact that natural gas accounts for 76% of heating in Ontario, we learned that the Liberals' climate change plan will apparently phase out the use of natural gas. By converting a home from natural gas to electricity, it would cost about $4,500. That's in addition to the $3,000 a year more that it will cost to use electricity over natural gas. An article in the Financial Post said the ban on natural gas means Ontarians will either soon end up a lot colder or a lot poorer. Mr. Speaker, to the acting premier, which is it? Is this government making families and seniors a lot colder or impoverished?
Well, Speaker, once again, the opposition never fails to disappoint when it comes to actually inventing our policy, Speaker. In fact, despite what the opposition says, we are not forcing anyone off natural gas, Speaker. What we are doing is looking for ways to help homeowners save money and reduce.
Deputy Premier.
In fact, Speaker, we've announced $230 million to expand natural gas for northern and rural communities, and we've announced $100 million to help owners who use natural gas, oil, and propane to upgrade their homes, reduce their energy bills, and cut pollution, Speaker. This leader claims that he cares about the planet. I don't think
he
does.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, it appears like the acting premier hasn't seen the work and
Deputy
the pledges of the
leader.
Minister of the Environment or the Premier on their climate change plan. Because since the Liberals took power, Ontario hydro rates have gone up 325%. Unbelievable. That's three times the cost of any other good or service.
From Glengarry.
So naturally, the Liberal solution to this problem is to force 76% of families and businesses that use more affordable natural gas to convert to electric heating. That's going to cost the average family $4,500 to make the switch and $3,000 a year to heat their home thereafter that every single year. Mr. Speaker, how does the Liberal Party, how does this government believe families can afford to pay another $3,000 a year? It's ridiculous.
I can stand for an hour. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We are not banning natural gas. As a matter of fact, you'll continue to see more natural gas efficient heating cooling systems, and the Deputy Premier just outlined. Mr. Speaker, it's interesting the lack of understanding.
The member for Brentford, come to order.
Mr. Speaker.
Just in case he didn't hear, and he's now doing it again, the member from Renfrew come to order. And that'll get you another one if it continues. Finish, please.
The expanding natural gas is in areas like trucking as well, where it's a lower carbon fuel relative to that. But, Mr. Speaker, one of the other things we'll be doing, and this is company in the Leader of the Opposition's own constituency, there's a company called Royal Park Homes who are building net zero buildings that cost almost nothing. This talk about increased costs is absolutely nonsense.
As
a matter of fact, they have.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the acting premier. It's bad enough the acting premier hasn't read the government's climate change plan, but it appears like the Minister of the Environment has forgot about his own speeches and hasn't read his own plan, because the government's plan to phase out natural gas is foolish. This government has spent billions building and moving natural gas power plants. They spent millions expanding natural gas to rural municipalities and have promised to spend millions more. The Liberals want bus fleets to switch to natural gas, and then they come up with a plan to take natural gas out of homes. As the Minister of Energy would say, the Liberals are all over the map. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, why are they taking the choice away from households? Mr. Speaker, why won't houses be able to heat with natural gas when this Liberal government has spent years investing millions and millions into the natural gas?
Start the clock. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Member from Leeds Grenville, come to order. Carry on.
I would like to invite the member for the Leader of the Opposition. And maybe he can join me and the member for Barrie, and we will take him to Royal Park Homes. We'll go to London, and we'll introduce him to Sifton Homes. Or right here in Toronto, we can go out to Mimico on the Go, and you can see what the other technologies are that we're going to help incent that lower.
We're getting close to warnings. And I'll convert to warnings. If I sit down and I hear a peep, we're going to warnings. Finish, please.
So the member doesn't seem to be aware that in his own constituency, in his neighbor's constituents, we have some of the leading low-carbon some of them are cogen. There is a whole range of technologies, as there are in the auto sector. We're not taking natural gas heating away from anyone. When people come to replace their old systems, they'll be able to get
technology. Thank you. New question. The member from Nipissing.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Finance. This morning, the Financial Accountability Officer confirmed what we here have been saying for months. This government is using one-time money from the sale of assets, contingency funds, and tax increases to try to balance their budget. Yet the FAO says they'll still come up short in 2017-18, and he forecasts a $600 million deficit. He says this will grow as large as $3.5 billion by 2020 if economic growth changes even slightly. When asked about whether this government is properly balancing the risks, the FAO said, quote, "We don't believe this fiscal plan does." Speaker, will the minister finally admit there's a structural deficit in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to begin by thanking the Financial Accountability Officer for his report. We collaborated with the Financial Accountability Officer, and his forecasts and recommendations and the risks that he highlights is appropriate, and we're mindful of them. It's why we take the actions and the prudent measures that we've achieved. And Mr. Speaker, I quote, and he says that the government has the ability and is able to balance its deficit, and the government is doing just that in 2017-18 and the year after that. And on this side of the House, we're committed to balancing the books and ensuring that we grow the economy and create more jobs. He goes on to say that, and I quote, "Ontario's economy will outperform the rest of Canada in 2016. He says, over the next several years, most economic forecasters, including the FAO, expect Ontario economy will grow at a solid pace, supported by strong gains in international exports and business investments. Mr. Speaker, we are taking the necessary actions. We are growing the economy. We're balancing the books next year and the year after that."
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the minister. I'm surprised he suggested they collaborated, Speaker. The FAO says they were blocked with, quote, cabinet confidentiality at every turn. The FAO was clear, quote, "This fiscal plan is not evenly balanced." Quote, "Most risk is on the downside." He also said he has, quote, "serial disappointment in the government's projections."
Wow.
Speaker, their forecasts have missed the targets in each of the past 5 years.
Order.
That means without selling assets, they won't meet revenue targets. Speaker, after 2018-19, the FAO projects a deterioration in the province's budget balance with a deficit of $1.7 billion by 2020. That's in his report. Speaker, he also forecasts net debt will continue to skyrocket with $54 billion added. So my question is, will the minister admit that government waste, scandal and mismanagement is hurting Ontario?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, in addition to the FAO, who used outside external support to establish his forecast, I also note that the credibility of the 2016 budget is on fiscal plan. In fact, Moody's recently upgraded Ontario's credit rating outlook based on our government's economic and fiscal plan. And the Conference Board of Canada indicated that a balanced budget 2017-18 is in reach. Furthermore, the very proposals being put forward by the FAO is appropriate in terms of providing some sensitivity around those potential risks, which we as a government have always been addressing. It is why, for the seventh year in a row, Mr. Speaker, we're outperforming, achieving better results than previously anticipated, even with lower revenues, Mr. Speaker, and the appropriate prudence that the member opposite talks about in regards to contingencies is appropriate, and the FAO made that very clear today.
Back to the minister. Yes, the FAO confirmed again, Speaker, that they'll only balance by selling assets. He also reported that the government is on track to continue starving our health care system while we're seeing nurses fired regularly. The FAO says cost factors mean they should be increasing health care spending 5.2% average per year, yet they're capping it at 1.8%. Speaker, he told us that is not realistic. This government was told how their waste, mismanagement and scandal would crowd out critical spending, and now the FAO this morning confirmed that indeed has happened. Just how many more nurses will this government have to fire? How many more hospital rooms will this government have to close to balance their budget?
Thank you. Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite has just reinforced the very nature of the transformations that are being necessary to be included in our plan without sacrificing those very essential services in health care and education. It is why we are increasing health care by an additional $1 billion more, Mr. Speaker. It is why we are supporting more education, including free tuition for our most vulnerable students. It is why we're investing more than $12 billion more in capital for creating new hospitals. And it is why the FAO has stated that those are prudent measures, measures that are offsetting and mitigating the risk. The FAO highlights the fact that prudence is included in our budget. The member opposite knows that fully well, and if he doesn't, that's because he doesn't understand, Mr. Speaker.
He does not.
Good question. The member from Bramley, Gore-Moulton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Deputy Premier. The Liberal government has spent the last week insisting that overcrowded hospitals aren't a problem. And apparently, that's why Liberals think they don't need any standards with respect to occupancy. But even though Liberals won't admit it, their own numbers prove it, that hospitals across Ontario are stretched beyond their limits. And it's not just acute beds that are being affected, Mr. Speaker. It's mental health beds as well. Will the Deputy Premier admit that Liberal cuts mean that mental health beds across Ontario are filled to over 100% capacity?
Well, should Minister of Health and Long-Term Care come to order?
Year after year across this province.
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
You know, Speaker, I do want to make it clear that we are very much aware of the challenges our hospitals are facing. The difference, though, between the position of the NDP and the position of the government is that the solution to that is, in their case, they argue building more hospital beds. Our solution is build more beds where they are necessary, but wherever possible, when people are ready to leave the hospital, provide the supports for them outside the hospital, in the community, or in their home, Speaker. That is the focus of the transformation that is underway in our health care system across the province. It's what patients want. It's what's right for the health care system, Speaker. I do not understand why the third party is fixated on a model of care that does not meet the needs of patients.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, Speaker, far too many families in this province know how hard it is, how difficult it is to get mental health support services when you really need it. And now the government's own record proves that mental health beds are stretched beyond their limit across this province. London Health Sciences has been running at over 100% capacity for more than 2.5 years. Thunder Bay Regional has spent the last 2 years filled beyond capacity, and Sioux Area Hospital has also most recently reached more than 107% capacity. How can the acting premier defend even more Liberal cuts when mental health beds are stretched to such capacity, are over capacity, and so massively overcrowded across the province?
Thank you, Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, once again, clarify, there are no cuts to health care. In fact, we are increasing spending by $1 billion in the budget that we passed that they voted against, Speaker. And mental health care is a significant part of the increase in health care spending because we are all very, very acutely aware of the importance of investing in appropriate mental health services, Speaker. And we have actually put our money where our mouth is. We know that 1 in 5 Ontarians is going to experience a mental health illness, Speaker, and we have a strong record of investing in mental health services and addictions. Since 2003,
the
budget's gone up by $500 million. And every year, we're spending $3 billion on mental health and addiction services.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It isn't just London, Thunder Bay, or Sault Ste. Marie that are facing this mental health crisis. Mental health beds in Ottawa, St. Catharines, Burlington are all filled beyond capacity, Mr. Speaker. Hospitals in Kitchener, Oshawa, Whitby, and North Bay have also reached their limits. When hospitals are overcrowded, it takes even longer for folks who need mental health supports to get the care that they so desperately need, Mr. Speaker. That's what happens when you freeze hospital budgets, when you lay off frontline care providers, and when you close beds in hospitals. When will this government stop cutting hospital services?
Well, Speaker, once again, it's not just about hospitals. They are a very important part of our health care system, but when people are ready to leave hospitals, there has to be a place for them to go that is safe and that will keep them well, Speaker, which is why we're focusing on increasing the number of supportive housing units. We have committed to building 1,000 more supportive housing units, 248 of them, Speaker, in this year alone. So we are focusing on getting people the care they need in the right place. That is what our position on health care is. Understand the needs of patients, build the capacity where the need is the greatest, and don't keep people in hospital longer than they need to be in hospital, Speaker.
Thank you. New question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Same member.
Again, thank you, sir. It's again to the Deputy Premier. The Premier has tweeted, and I quote, "We can't ignore mental health." But the trouble is, Mr. Speaker, that's exactly what this Premier and this government are doing. Liberal cuts mean that mental health beds across Ontario are overcrowded. And this Liberal government just keeps on cutting services, laying off workers, and making it harder for families to access the mental health supports that they need. It begs the question, why does this government have no standards or policy with respect to overcrowding so that people who need, patients who need the mental health services can actually access those mental health services?
Deputy Premier.
You know, Speaker, we have listened over and over and over again to allegations that we are cutting health care. That is patently false, and I urge the third party to really think long and hard about whether they want to stand up day after day and make a statement that simply is not true. We are investing more in health care, Speaker. We are investing more. Mental health is a priority area for our new investments in health care. So I think the people of this province actually expect people from all sides of this House to base their arguments on the facts. When they talk about cuts, Speaker, they are simply not reflecting the accurate situation in this province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much. Mr. Speaker, fixing mental health services means funding hospitals properly. It means ensuring that when someone needs care, they can actually access the care, and that should be a policy the government should implement. But the crisis of overcrowding in hospitals won't be fixed by a handful of feel-good tweets or Liberal talking points, and it certainly won't be fixed with another year of cuts to hospital services.
Deputy House Leader, second time.
Cuts to frontline healthcare workers. Will the Deputy Premier look at the government's own numbers and realize and admit that there's a crisis in Ontario's mental health services and stop cutting hospital services in this province?
Thank you, Deputy Premier.
You know, Speaker, we on this side of the House have really focused on improving the system of mental health care. I think all of us would agree that the system that we inherited was a pretty disjointed system that did not serve the people of this province very well. That's why we created the Comprehensive Addictions and Mental Health Strategy to support Ontarians from childhood into old age with the right supports at the right time and in the right place, Speaker. The first phase of the plan is to increase funding by $220 million over 3 years to our mental health and addictions agencies. That is not a cut. That's $220 million more. The first 3 years of the strategy focused on children, and I'm very happy to report that an additional 50,000 children have received supports,
answer,
addiction and mental health services as a result of our increased investments in mental health.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. There is a silent crisis in health care in this province. Patients know it, families know it, and New Democrats are determined to fix it. Liberal cuts have overcrowded our mental health beds in this province, and the Liberal government literally has no plan to deal with it. Instead, their plan is to implement more cuts, to lay off more frontline care providers, and to close more beds. People deserve mental health services when and where they need it, and Ontarians deserve a government that shares this priority. When will the government stop ignoring the facts, stop ignoring the overcrowding in mental health hospital beds across this province, and stop the cuts to Ontario hospitals?
Thank you.
Well, Speaker, I don't know how many times I have to say it. Maybe we should send a copy of the budget over so that the third party actually understands we're increasing investments in our health care system. In stark contrast, I might say, to the 300 beds, mental health beds, that they closed when they were in office, Speaker.
But our investments in community
mental health are making a difference, and we see that in our communities. And I urge members from all parties to actually understand what's happening in their communities to improve access to services with mental health challenges and with addiction, Speaker.
Thank you. New question. The member from McKean-Carleton.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. The Auditor General earlier this morning confirmed that the Liberal government paid over $19 million in secret payouts to education stakeholders, above and beyond contract negotiation, transfer payments, and even the $600,000 at the Sheraton Hotel. $22 million of that, Speaker, was undocumented. The Liberals took this money out of classrooms intended for students. And I want to quote from the Auditor General, "We found very little evidence of governments paying education sector unions for significant bargaining costs anywhere else in Canada. Accordingly, Ontario is an outlier with respect to the use of taxpayer funds." Mr. Speaker, this practice only stopped when the government got caught. They have admitted this was wrong and that the money came from kids in classrooms. How does the Minister of Education justify taking $90 million out of the classroom when it was intended for students?
Can you say that, please? Thank you. Minister of Education.
First of all, I absolutely reject the issue that it was taken out of classrooms. It was not taken out of classroom money. It was taken out of what's called Education Program Other, which is used for funding professional development. So it was not taken out of classrooms. That's just a totally incorrect interpretation. What I will say is that we have a long-standing practice in Ontario of working with all our partners. We actually believe that when it comes to professional development, that it's most effective if everybody is part of it. We fund school boards for professional development. We fund the directors' organization.
Answer.
We fund teacher organizations. We fund subject organizations, faculties of education, and yes,
thank you,
teachers' union.
Supplementary.
Perhaps the minister would like to read the report as I did, and she would understand that her interpretation of the auditor's report is wrong. It came directly from the Elementary and Secondary School Education Development Fund, meaning it came from grants for needs of students. Exactly where that came from. Liberals are now closing provincial and demonstration schools. They're kicking kids off the autism wait list, as we saw yesterday. They're closing rural schools, including urban schools, because my daughter's school might be on the chopping block, Mr. Speaker. 38 school boards had to cut their student special education funding to the tune of, guess what, $22 million. Parents are forced to fundraise in Windsor for basic needs, including school repairs. So I'll go back. Generously ask the government, education minister, for a second chance at responding to me. Why is this government forcing kids to sit in portables with their jackets on all winter at the same time that they are sending $90 million undocumented. And what kind of priority is this?
Order. Start the clock. A reminder for everyone, you speak to the chair. Minister?
Yes, thank you, Chair. And of course, the money did not come from the grant for student needs. The grant for student needs is a regulation which very clearly lays out the calculation for money to go to school boards, and we follow that regulation always. But let me tell you, Mr. Speaker, what the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development had to say about professional development in Ontario, the OECD. It said, and I quote, "The Ontario experience suggests instead that by treating teachers as professionals and including them at the table, they were able, that's Ontario was able to build considerable goodwill, a critical resource for long-term and sustainable."
Answer, please.
The Ontario government was able to direct that energy towards win-win issues like providing more professional development time. Ultimately, the Ontario government created a sustainable.
Thank you. Thank you. New question, the member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Children and Youth Services. Yesterday, member after member from the opposition benches got up and told heartbreaking stories of the impact of this government's plan to kick children over the age of 5 out of IBI therapy. Parents sat in the chamber sobbing, while Liberal members sat with their BlackBerries, smiling, turning their backs to debate, and laughing with their colleagues.
Order, please. Order, please. Order. Order. What's your question, please?
Speaker, this government continues to be truly disrespectful to the parents of this province. You can't claim to care deeply about the stories parents are telling you if you don't even give the respect to listen to them. How many parents have to leave this legislature in tears before this government starts to listen?
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Well, Speaker, where to start with this? First of all, I admire and respect all the members who were here in the legislature yesterday when the families and groups were here, whether that was question period, whether it was the 3 hours in the afternoon for the opposition debate. I think all members paid attention and listened to the debate with interest. We're very mindful of the families who are here. You know, I worry, Speaker, I worry about this critic talking in a way that's not factual, saying that we're taking kids out of therapy, and we're not. And we're not. Speaker.
Order.
Excuse me. You have one sentence. Wrap up.
You. I ask all members of the House to stick to the facts. I ask them not to use language like kicking kids out of therapy. That is not what we're doing, Speaker. We're investing in kids.
Thank you.
We're creating a better program.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Before I start the clock, I would make a comment to the members of this chamber. If at any time that this assembly decides that they have lack of confidence in the chair, then put a motion forward and have a non-confidence vote in the chair. Supplementary.
Speaker, yesterday in debate, the minister tried to make it seem like these changes wouldn't have devastating impacts by saying, quote, the transition, though difficult, will not affect most families, end of quote. Speaker, that's an unacceptable argument. No child should be left behind. Every child matters. You can't deny full IBI funding to a specific group of kids already who were deemed eligible for IBI simply because they've turned 5. It's unjust, it's inequitable, and it's not fair. Why does this government think that children with autism of a certain age are only worth $8,000 and a place on yet another wait list?
Thank you. Can you see that, please? Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, I think, you know, if you put my remarks from yesterday in context, what I was trying to focus on is there is a group. There's a group of the 40,000 children with autism in this process who are going to be experiencing the biggest changes through this new program. And it's important, Speaker, that we support them individually on a case-by-case basis, and that's what I was talking about yesterday. We agree that autism doesn't end at 5, Speaker, and in the new program, all children with a diagnosis, including those children 5 and over, will get better service, they'll get it sooner, and it'll be customized to meet their individual needs, including those children who need more intensive therapies and support. This is a continuum of care, Speaker, we're moving towards. We want to make sure that all children get the right support at the
Answer,
right age.
Answer, the member from Hamilton Mountain, come to order.
On clinical advice and assessments, and that's what, exactly what
Thank
we're
you.
Going to do.
Good question. The member from Cumberland, Quincy.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. Minister, there's been questions raised about the future of natural gas in the province, following discussions about the upcoming climate change action plan. Consumers and businesses are hearing from media reports and the opposition that they will be forced off natural gas into heating their homes with electricity. Minister, the 2016 provincial budget committed to expanding natural gas to communities across Ontario, including communities in rural Ontario. Not only has natural gas traditionally been a very cost-effective option for home heating, it is very important to rural Ontario. It's used for many industrial and commercial agriculture activities. Minister, can you please clarify for the members of this House
question?
And all Ontarians what this government plan for natural gas is?
Great question.
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for Northumberland Quinte West Excellent. For this important question, who's a champion for concerns right across all of rural Ontario. Let me be clear. Our government knows how much a priority of natural gas is for rural Ontario. Despite what the opposition or anybody else is saying, we're not forcing anyone off natural gas. There will not be climate change police in the province of Ontario seizing natural gas furnaces or fireplaces. That's a false statement that people on this side are making. It is wrong, Mr. Speaker.
It's silly.
We are not abandoning or reducing our investments in this area. In fact, as the member knows, he mentioned our government's commitment to expanding natural gas, including our $200 million natural gas access loan program to be launched this year, and another $30
million. Wrap up, please.
Mr. Speaker, another $30 billion will go towards the Natural Gas Economic Development Grant to extend natural gas to rural communities. This government is committed to expanding natural
gas. Thank you. State it, please. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Mr. Speaker, thank you to the Minister for that answer. I appreciate the Minister providing clarification on this issue. On this side of the House, our government has taken positive steps to combat climate change by curbing our greenhouse gas emission and investing in renewable energy.
Yeah.
Now, as we look to the future and envision what is next, we have to think critically of what the major sources of greenhouse gas emissions are in this province. Building in Ontario accounted for 19% of our province's greenhouse gas emission in 2013, our third largest source of emission. The good news is the building sectors also hold the most potential for delivering significant and cost-effective greenhouse gas emission reduction and will play a key role in providing transformation to the low-carbon economy. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister please inform the House
question.
On the specific role that natural gas will play in helping in the transition?
Great question.
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture.
To my colleague, the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
I also want to thank my colleague from Northumberland, Quinte West. And I am not going to be able to match the eloquence of the Minister of Agricultural Affairs and Food. But, Mr. Speaker, we continue to see a critical role in the energy mix for natural gas, Mr. Speaker, including in trucking and other areas. That's why this past February, Mr. Speaker, as you would know, our government announced a $100 million partnership with Enbridge and Union Gas as part of the down payment on cap and trade, Mr. Speaker. We will be presenting a plan that will benefit customers, lower costs for households and businesses to reach our emissions targets, Mr. Speaker. And finally, I can say with confidence that natural gas will have an important role in that process, and we will also continue to invest in fossil-free technologies that consumers choose to purchase as well.
Answer.
This is a good news story.
Thank you. Good question. The member from Dufferin-Caledon.
My question is to the Minister of Youth Services. The minister and her colleagues ignored experts and thousands of parents when they voted down our motion to restore IBI therapy for children over the age of five. The Raptors weren't the only thing lighting up Twitter last night. There were hundreds of tweets by parents and individuals that are disappointed, no, disgusted, with yesterday's vote. One individual wrote the minister stating, "Explain to me how your side's empty when it's time to listen and full when it's time to vote." Another wrote, "Disgusted with the Ontario Liberals tonight. They had an opportunity to do the right thing and voted not to." These people won't give up. We won't give up. I ask again, will the minister reverse her decision and allow children over the age of five access to IBI therapy?
You see it, please? You see it, please? Thank you, Minister.
Well, Speaker, I don't think I have to tell my other critic here what I think she already knows, is that members of this legislature participate on committees and have other responsibilities. So not everybody from any parties in the House at all times, if that's what she's suggesting. I think that's outrageous. But Speaker, we do listen to parents, we do listen to families, and you know what, Speaker? When all members of this legislature were speaking yesterday, I was listening, I was taking notes, particularly the stories of families, because it helps inform the direction we're going. It helps inform the implementation of the new program. So I appreciated the participation of all members in the House yesterday. And, you know, Speaker, I'll say once again, this is an historic investment of $333 million on top of $190 million a year and 16,000 new spaces. We want this to work for all children who require autism support services at the right time, at the right.
Thank you. Supplementary.
The minister doesn't seem to understand the impact this decision is having on families. Here's some facts for you. It means Kelly McDowell's daughter.
Come to order. Supplementary.
These are not my stories. These are stories from families. Kelly McDowell's daughter, who has benefited from IBI therapy, where she can now tell her parents that she loves them, will never be able to complete her therapy. It means Megan Stevens' son, who has been told he is a perfect candidate for IBI therapy, will never experience that impact this life-changing therapy has. It's time for the minister to do the
right thing. Come to order.
And reverse her decision so each child in our province can become the best they can be.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Start the clock. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Comment, Speaker. Like, children will never get a certain therapy. It sounds like the case the member is talking about is a child who is in IBI therapy. They'll continue to get IBI therapy, and they will be assessed by a clinician. And then the plan of action for that child will be determined going forward. Let's not forget, Speaker, let's not forget that it's her party and her leader that voted against this new investment in autism. Absolutely. Their motion, as we discussed yesterday, would keep kids on wait lists longer. That's unacceptable. We cannot have kids on wait lists for the length of time they've been there now, growing to 5 years. Speaker, the new program recognizes that there is no age cutoff for services going forward, that there's a continuum of care required, that children will get the right support.
Member from Dufferin Caledon, come to order.
Clinical assessments, not for the same absolute thing.
Thank you. New question. The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you. Speaker, my question is to the Acting Premier. Today's FAO report is unequivocal in its findings. The government plans to reduce program spending is happening across most areas. Planned spending growth in health and education, for example, is about half the rate it should be in order to keep up with population growth and other cost pressures. According to the report, this means that program expenses would need to be $4 billion higher by 2018 and 19 compared to what was written in the 2016 budget. Mind you, this is only if the status quo remains, and Ontarians know that the quality of public services under this Liberal government only continues to decline. My question, how long are Ontarians expected to go without?
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question. I also appreciate, as I've mentioned, the work done by the FEO in this regard, recognizing how important it is for us to take note of the fact that the structures in place, the status quo, must be amended without sacrificing the very services that are important to Ontarians, like health care and education. It's one of the reasons we're investing much more in health care, $1 billion alone this year,
wow,
as well as $12 billion over the next 10 years to support new hospitals and new hospice cares and new services for the people of Ontario when it comes to health care. The FAO also makes reference to the fact that we are coming to balance. He also notes some of the risks that are involved that we must address, and we are doing just that. It's also why we've built in quite a bit of prudence into the system. But the member opposite is asking a very important question, a question being, can we stay the way we are, or must we make the appropriate changes to improve our services while being mindful of the taxpayers as we proceed forward and balancing the books at the same time?
Mr. Speaker, you know, this government likes to congratulate itself on having the lowest program spending per person in the country. But Ontarians know what that means. They are living a painful Liberal reality in Ontario. They know it means less money for health care. Our hospitals are already overcrowded, as we've heard. It means less money for education. Kids with special needs are already not getting the supports they need. And more money is spent cleaning up Liberal mistakes. All in all, it simply means less money for the things that Ontarians depend on, the people that we're supposed to be working for, the people that we are elected to serve. My question is simple. When will this Liberal government put the needs of Ontarians first?
Mr. Speaker, I'm very proud on this side of the House that we have been putting Ontarians' needs first every budget that we've presented that I've had the pleasure of doing. And I must admit, I have to ask the member opposite this very question. On page 9 of her platform, they promised to make $600 million in unspecified cuts every year. This member opposite stood in that and said that the way to find the savings, the way to make those cuts, isn't health care, by her own admission. We're not doing that on this side of the House, Mr. Speaker. We're investing more than health care. We're providing for the people of Ontario.
The member from Ottawa South.
Mr. Speaker, and my question is for the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. I understand that last week the Minister was invited to be part of the Canadian delegation to the 15th session of the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. And I know that our government is committed to working with the federal government on issues of shared priority and concern. It's great to see that Ontario was asked to stand with Canada on the world stage at this important forum. Can the Minister please tell us more about his participation in the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues?
Thank you. Minister Robertson first.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you for that question. It was a great honour to join my federal counterpart, Minister Carolyn Bennett, Ontario First Nation leadership, Métis leadership and Inuit leaders, and more than 1,000 other Indigenous participants from across the world at the United Nations for this forum. The overarching theme of this year's session was conflict, peace and resolution, leading to a very productive discussion on issues related to lands, territories, resources, rights, and distinct identities. It was a pleasure to have the opportunity to further join Minister Bennett in a forum discussion entitled Empowering Indigenous Women with various delegations from Australia and New Zealand. Speaker, it was clear that Canada now has a voice on the world stage when it comes to Indigenous issues. And I am proud that Ontario was able to be a part of that delegation. I am proud that Canada is back on the international stage.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you very much to the Minister for the update on his participation at the United Nations. It was also good to hear that he was invited to take part in the panel on empowering Indigenous women. And his exposure to the experiences of Indigenous women in other countries and governments will be important in our own long-term strategy to end violence against Indigenous women. I also understand that while at the UN, the Minister's federal counterpart also announced that Canada would be removing its permanent objector status from the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could he please tell us more about the lessons learned from his trip that will benefit the work of our government? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, as Ontario moves forward on the implementation of our long-term strategy and our response to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, it is important to consider the lessons we can learn from the experience and successes of other countries. It was an honour again to join Canada for the Empowering Indigenous Women Roundtable to hear the perspectives of other countries in addressing this very important issue, and I thank Minister Bennett for this opportunity. It was great to hear a very good news story that the federal government is reversing its stance on the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Our government is committed to working with our Indigenous partners as we follow the federal government's leadership in developing a national plan for the implementation of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples.
Thank you. New question, the member from Perth, Wellington.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Energy. It concerns the future of natural gas, which this government seems intent to eliminate. My question is this. Why isn't the minister speaking up for affordable energy? And whose side is he taking? Is it the Minister of Economic Development who wrote, "My ministry heard of the importance of natural gas. In particular, we heard that remote communities face large expansion costs due to access the resource." Or is it the Minister of the Environment who said, "Home heating is the future. In the future, is going to have to come from sources other than natural gas"?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Speaker, I'm happy to speak to the member, particularly in view of the fact that he has rural constituents, Mr. Speaker. He will know that we have taken some very significant steps to mitigate, Mr. Speaker, the costs in the rural areas. We do that, Mr. Speaker, by having a policy of expanding natural gas into rural communities. We're doing it through the Ontario Energy Board, Speaker. We've changed the regulations to allow a longer period of time, Mr. Speaker, to recoup the capital. We have the loan program for rural natural gas expansion. We have a loan program and a grant program for rural areas, Mr. Speaker. We are taking all kinds of steps. Hydro One, Mr. Speaker, has a new program for heat pumps, Mr. Speaker, which can be installed in rural residences that will take between $800 and $1,500 off their electricity bills every year. We are working for the rural community when it comes to prices of electricity.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, back in February, I wrote to the government about the need for natural gas access in Milverton, which I represent. I've seen responses from the Premier, the Minister of Economic Development, and the OEB, but not the Minister of Energy. Now we know the Liberals are planning a $7 billion climate plan, which threatens to throw up new barriers to natural gas in rural Ontario. Unbelievably, it proposes to ban natural gas from all homes and small buildings built in 2030 or later.
Order.
It's yet another Liberal policy dreamed up with zero thought to rural Ontario. Will the minister stand with the people of Perth East and support the township's position on natural gas, or will he stand with his out-of-control colleague, the Minister of the Environment?
And I was trying to listen to the question when the member from Renfrew took me off my listening.
I invite the member to inform himself as to what's happening at the Ontario Energy Board, Mr. Speaker. He may not be aware of the fact that Union Gas has an application before the Ontario Energy Board. The hearings are in process, Mr. Speaker, to expand natural gas to 5 rural communities, Mr. Speaker. And Union Gas is also working with 18 or 19 other rural communities, Mr. Speaker, to make similar applications before rural communities. They don't want to admit, Mr. Speaker, in the Conservative Party, that we are paying attention to rural customers. We're taking steps to mitigate the rates, Mr. Speaker, and we'll continue to do so.
Thank you. New question. The member from Timmins, James B.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. Perhaps it's surprising to you that those who move from Quebec to Hearst and want to start a business in Hearst, they come here and they want to be able to offer a service to those in the north.
Standards and safety authority, parce que eux autres ils faisaient rien en français, ils se fait dire non.
They finally hear that no, you cannot do your test in French. Not only can you not do it in French, but you can't even do it even if you pay. You're not able to do this test in French. Does the deputy minister think that it's acceptable to refuse French language tests with the Technical Services Authority? Is this correct? I think not.
Minister responsible for Francophone Affairs.
Minister responsible for francophone affairs.
Premièrement, je veux remercier le député de Timmins James Bay pour sa question. Je n'étais pas au courant que ce processus-là était en place puis qu'on n'avait pas le droit.
Oh, first of all, let me thank the member for his question. I was not aware that such a system existed. I also didn't know there were issues in the system, but I will talk to people in charge to definitely fix this issue, especially in the north and in Hearst, where almost 90% of the population is francophone. We should have services in French. Thank you. Thank you. Minister, I thank you for your answer, and I really hope that you will be able to fix these problems, because these technical safety authorities have been exempted from the French Language Services Act, so they are under no obligation to provide services in French. So how do we help people in Hearst who need to take this exam? How do we make sure that this organization is subject to the law? Thank you. The Minister for Government Services.
First of all, the TSSA is responsible for regulating fuel safety and other areas of safety standards, and it is certainly my expectation of all of the delegated administrative authorities and agencies in the province that they conduct business in both official languages. And so this is the first that I've heard of this issue with respect to the TSSA. I'm happy to have a conversation with the member opposite and follow up. And I will be speaking, obviously, Speaker, to the TSSA in regard to the way in which they conduct business with respect to their services, and that all Ontarians, whether they speak French or English, have access to all of the services provided by the TSSA. Thank you, Speaker.
Okay, new question, the member from Etobicoke-Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Mr. Speaker, from my experience as a municipal councillor, I had a front-row view of the difficulties facing municipalities in delivering affordable housing. And Mr. Speaker, as this House will know, I have been a strong proponent of a planning tool called inclusionary zoning. Mr. Speaker, in many communities across the province, increasing housing prices and rent costs are making it difficult for people to find housing they can afford to rent or buy. A few months ago, our government took actions to address this by releasing an updated long-term affordable housing strategy. And if passed, this would introduce legislation that would make inclusionary zoning a reality in communities across this province. Mr. Speaker, will the minister provide this House with an update on the development of a proposed inclusionary zoning framework?
Thank you. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Speaker, and thank the member from Etobicoke-Lakeshore and also the member from High Park, who have both have a long history of advocating for inclusionary zoning. It's important. Speaker, today, later this afternoon, I will be introducing the Promoting Affordable Housing Act, which would, if passed, help to ensure that the people of Ontario have better access to affordable and adequate housing. These changes will enable municipalities to offer incentives and use other planning measures such as heightened density to support the creation of affordable units in partnership with the development sector. Speaker, our neighbourhoods are stronger and more vital when they include a mix of people who are able to choose where they live from a range of housing. That will be the intent of the legislation. I'm sure all members of the House will be delighted to see it this
supplementary.
Afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for his answer and for his leadership on this issue. Mr. Speaker, my community of Toronto has long sought the ability to have inclusionary zoning. Toronto's chief planner, Jennifer Keysmat, has said that a lack of access to this planning tool has resulted in the loss of the opportunity to create tens of thousands of units that would be affordable. And inclusionary zoning has also been requested by York Region, Peel Region, the Region of Waterloo, the City of Hamilton, and other municipalities.
Mr. Speaker, we recognize that inclusionary zoning is not a magic wand or a silver bullet that will do away with housing challenges. But what's important to note that proposed Promoting Affordable Housing Act will put forward other suggested measures to increase the supply of affordable housing in Ontario and continue the transformation of the social housing system.
Question.
Through you, will the minister highlight some of these other proposals in the bill?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, the honourable member is correct. In addition to the groundbreaking proposals associated with inclusionary zoning, there will be some other tools that will be made available which will allow our municipal partners who operate social housing more flexibility, Mr. Speaker, in administering and delivering social housing in their communities, helping to reduce wait lists and, frankly, just making it easier for Ontarians to embrace a bunch of options. Further changes would make secondary suites and new homes a potential source of affordable rental units for low to moderate income renters, less costly to build by exempting them from development charges. Speaker, with our proposed package of changes, we are taking meaningful actions to transform Ontario's housing system and end chronic homelessness within the next decade.
Thank you. New question, the member from Chatham-Kent-Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of the Environment. My constituents are furious after the premature release of the minister's plan to abandon natural gas in Ontario. Mark called it a lunatic plan. Mary said there had to be some sort of...
Order. Start the clock. Finish, please.
Mary said this better be some sort of delayed April Fool's prank. I'm beyond furious with this ridiculous plan, wrote Joan. Speaker, many have wondered how they will pay their bills while others are worried about their jobs. There is basically one industry that provides economic safety in this county. That's the county of Chatham-Kent, and it's Union Gas,
question,
said Sharon. Union Gas employs 850 people in Chatham-Kent and thousands throughout Ontario. We need these jobs. So, Speaker, to the minister,
the
minister please let my constituents know why he wants to
thank you.
Natural gas.
I stand, you sit. Minister of the Environment and Climate.
So, Mr. Speaker, as my colleague, the Minister of Child and Youth Services, said, it's important to stick to the facts in these conversations. So, fact number one, Mr. Speaker, if I haven't said it enough, we are not banning or removing natural gas heating or cooling. I don't know how many times you have to say that, and you'll see it when the plan comes out. But, Mr. Speaker, maybe the member can talk to my colleague from London.
Finish, please.
Could talk to my friend from Northern London North Centre, and she'll introduce him in his neighbourhood to Sifton Homes, which is building net zero, very low cost, what are called prosumer homes, where these people have the lowest heating and cooling bills almost in Ontario. They're being built all around him, and when Ontarians choose those net zero homes with very low cost, they should get help from this government too, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the minister. The agriculture and greenhouse industry
York,
in my riding would also like clarification about the environmental's plan to abandon natural gas. The Ontario Federation of Agriculture has been asking for an expansion of natural gas for years, and this government was patting itself on the back for promising an investment in gas lines only just a few months ago. Recently, the minister sent a letter to the OEB saying that the provincial government was committed to expanding natural gas service in rural Ontario. But now the industry is shocked after hearing these plants may be abandoned. And, Minister, you need to reconsider and ensure the need for natural gas expansion in Ontario. So, Speaker, to the minister, will the minister promise, will promises made to expand natural gas lines in rural Ontario be honored?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the investments we're making in natural gas and more efficient natural gas, in cogen, in geothermal, in battery, and a whole range of Ontario companies, amazing technologies, will give Ontarians more choice in home heating cooling, lower costs, and reduce GHGs. In fact, Mr. Speaker, I'm working almost monthly with the greenhouse industry because part of the challenge with the changing climate is we have to grow more food in protected environments, Mr. Speaker, and they're working, they're co-authoring the plan with us, and that will be a big boon in the ag sector. And the OFA, Don McCabe, is on our working group. He knows, and maybe the minute member could talk to Mr. McCabe from the OFA to get his facts corrected, because Mr. McCabe certainly understands them, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Minister of Finance on a point of order.
I'd like to introduce our interns to the Minister of Finance this summer, Marie Visca, Julia MacArthur, Eduardo Rodriguez, who are in our members' gallery. Welcome to people.
From Hamilton Mountain on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I had some guests join us after introductions this morning, so I'd like to welcome to the House my brother, David Taylor, as well as a family friend, Ken Haddell. Welcome to Queen's Park.
Thank you. The member from Davenport.
And I'd like to introduce a constituent of mine from the riding of Davenport, Samantha Tomei, who attends St. Joseph's College School and was recently selected as a recipient of the Herbert H. Carnegie Future ACE Citizenship Award and Scholarship, and is here today with her guidance counselor, Ida Costa. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you. The Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to introduce the team that worked on Bill 172 in our ministry, Mr. Speaker. Myra Hewitt, Laura Nemchin, David Harth, Heather Pearson, Sherry Beaton, Lisa Blackwell, Steve Bowe, Cash Theroux, David Mullock, and Ian Myrons, Mr. Speaker. A great team who worked for us.
Welcome.
Every day.
Thank you. We have a deferred vote on the motion of closure of the motion of third reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. Would all members please take their seats? On May 10, 2016, Mr. Murray moved third reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. Mr. Cole has moved that the question be now put. All those in favour of Mr. Cole's motion, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nagby.
Mr. Nagby.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayeux.
Madame Mayeux.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Rossetti.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. Thibault.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fideli.
Mr. Fideli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Ms. Hatfield. Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 51, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 51 and the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Murray has moved third reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gases. Is it the pleasure of the House, the motion carry? I heard a no. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say nay.
Nay.
In my opinion, the ayes have it. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. Mr. Murray has moved third reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayor.
Madame Mayor.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dom.
Mr. Dom.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Mrs. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Reneal.
Ms. Reneal.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. DeNova.
Ms. DeNova.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Fite.
Ms. Fite.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
What happened to you?
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Europe.
Mr. Europe.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
The ayes being 63 and the nays being 24, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, Troisième lecture, Projet de loi.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.